I will be discussing with you the key features and details of the K-12 curriculum or the Enhanced Basic Education Program. Hopefully, this will give you a better understanding of the program itself, and hopefully we can collectively make basic education more attainable and accessible to all Filipino learners. First of all, the curriculum framework is founded on several things. First, we already have the legal basis, which draws from the philosophical basis of education. For example, we have had 100 years of reform. We've had PRADED, we have PROBE, we had TEP, we had CDEEP, we had SEDP, we also had a lot of small reforms in different places, like for example, BIM. And then presently, we have BIM-ARM. No? So we are drawing from the learnings of various reform efforts. And this is also important because we are also drawing from learnings that have been crystallized from interventions with indigenous people. That's why it's very important that we are able to integrate inclusion into the basic education curriculum. That philosophy of inclusion is key in our curriculum. So, and that is embodied in our law. Our law is called RA 10533, the Basic Education Act of 2013. We also have the Kindergarten Education Act, which is 10157. And that's a very, these two in tandem are very important. I think that we need to be able to understand that these two laws together justify the implementation of K-12 already. We also consider, for example, the needs of the learner, the child's intellect, the development of the learner. And what we are trying to do in this curriculum is to give the learner different avenues. So we are moving from a curriculum that is singular, that is the same for everybody, to a curriculum that is more diverse. And hopefully that will allow us to teach diverse learners. So the diversity, the shift from singular to diverse is a difficult shift, and that's what we need to be able to understand in our curriculum. We are also considering how the Philippines is compared to the global community. For example, it would be better if we had 12 years of education, because this makes us consistent with most of the world. There was a time when we were only one of three countries that had 10 years of basic education. At least now we are at par with the world. However, it's not sufficient to add 2 years. Diba? What we need to be able to do is to improve all of it so that we have 12 years plus kindergarten of good basic education. We also need to consider that we have to make sure that while schools improve, communities improve. So if communities are improving, that means we are working with communities in delivering good education. I think that if we do this right, ako ha, tingin ko lang, if we do this right, we can actually leapfrog the educational system. This is now the slide that shows us a synopsis of what the education program is. First, our objective, no, is to develop the Filipino with 21st century skills. Now, we have defined 21st century skills in DepEd as those skills that contain information media technology skills, learning innovation skills, communication skills, and life and career skills. These are the integrative skills. Okay. The integrative skills are not subjects. The subjects are the same. It's language, technology, livelihood, education, math and science, arts and humanities. And what we're trying to do is to make these two things interact. So in other words, while we teach them math, we are teaching them life and career skills. While we teach them TLE, we are teaching them information, media, technology skills. In other words, we don't just teach because of the subject matter. Ang gusto natin, ang lalabas na bata sa DepEd at sa edukasyon, ng basic education, ang lalabas na bata dyan, meron siya nitong apat na 21st century skills categories. To do that, we need a curriculum support system. We need to know what kind of teachers we need. We need to understand the materials, facilities, and equipment that will allow this to happen. What sort of ICT environment? What kind of assessment must we put in place so that we can make sure that these skills and sets of knowledge are learned? School leadership and management is also very important. You know, senior high school is a new thing. Diba? And a lot of our high school principals will have to learn the skill of connecting with the industries in their community, working with partners. And so we need to specify what sort of school leadership and management is required. We also need to be able to specify what technical assistance a division, a school's division, must be able to provide. So if a high school has, for example, STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math, if they have that, then who must be the supervisors in a division? So this is a very important item. And then finally, the community industry relevance and partnerships. For example, if we're going to set up an agri-fisheries school, we would like to set it up in a place that has land and is close to the sea. It would be very difficult to have agri-fisheries in Metro Manila, for example, because we don't have enough space or arable land. So we need this strong curriculum support system. And finally, and we are in the process of articulating this, is we need a monitoring and evaluation system for the entire K-12 reform. And that monitoring evaluation system will have to consider not only the NAT, because we're so used to that, we only think of the NAT. It should not be just the NAT. It should look at our input into schools. What do we give schools? Therefore, what can we expect back from schools? We also need to look at how have we trained our teachers. We also need to look at how have we chosen our school leaders. And of course, we need to look at the whole SBM or school-based management framework. This is very, very familiar to everybody. Now, this is how we encapsulate that the curriculum is drawing from the previous curriculum. We didn't reinvent the wheel, diba? But we did have to do some spreading of content. And of course, we had to add content because of senior high school. So basically, kinder to grade 10 is a spiral curriculum. Senior high school becomes more disciplinal. And then, what we're trying to say also in this framework is that we need support systems for the curriculum to succeed. And when the curriculum succeeds, hopefully, the child in the middle or the learner also succeeds. Yun yung isang mungkahi ko sa buong DepEd na huwag kakalimutan na yung lahat ng trabahong ginagawa natin para dun sa learner. Diba? The learner should be the one to benefit the most from this reform. Hindi siya dapat mahirapan. Dapat matulungan natin siya. Okay. There are four exits. There are two ways to look at the exits. The first one is the 21st century skills exits. And then the second one is the destination. Where do children go after basic education? They can go to higher ed, they can go directly to employment, they can go to entrepreneurship, and then they also can go to middle skills development, so further middle skills development. And to be able to do that, we will need very strong career advocacy or career advising. So this is another feature of high school that we really need to think about, no? And I think this is one that we haven't really planned out any interventions for, no? That's strong enough. We have a good 2 years to do this. We need to be able to help children understand what they want to be when they grow up. And we need to be able to explain to them that what they want to be now can change. And if it changes, it's okay. They can change their minds. So if they decide to go, let's say, into tech voc, after a few years, they want to go to college, that should be possible. Okay? The other thing that is important for all of us to remember is that DepEd is not moving alone. We are connected to the rest of the education system, and we are connected using the Philippine Qualifications Framework. The PQF has a progression from basic ed to TechVoc or TESDA, and then higher ed. In DepEd, we have to deliver two levels. Level 1 at the end of grade 10 and level 2 at the end of grade 12. This is level 1. So if the child is achieving level 1 through grade 10, then the child should possess foundational knowledge across a range of learning areas or competencies. And then this child should be able to apply this, and then the child needs supervision, very close supervision. At the end of grade 12, the knowledge should become functional and technical. And what this means is that you can apply scientific, critical, creative thinking, and use technologies in more specific areas of interest. And then you need minimal supervision. We are now proposing this one, proposal pa lang siya, we are proposing this one to the National Competency Council. We feel that it is important for DepEd to articulate this clearly. The reason for that is it translates to our key stages. We have four key stages: grade 3, grade 6, grade 10, and grade 12. In the formal system, that's what it looks like. In the ALS at the moment, our key stages are 6 and 10. So what we need to be able to do is also to find the way so that the key stages are relevant in both the formal and non-formal basic education approaches that DepEd delivers. Then what we need to do, and we are doing this already, and as a matter of fact, we are almost done, no, pretty much done. We convert this now into content and performance standards and learning competencies. The content and performance standards and learning competencies, this is what comprise the curriculum. And then on the basis of that curriculum, we make learning resources. Now, in a curriculum that is going to be used by more than 48,000 schools, you cannot expect the same curriculum happening every day, di ba? Curricula will change. That's why it's very important for us to have learning standards. The standard is the most important convergence point. We should all attain the standard. The children should meet them. So they refer to how well the student must perform, at what kinds of tasks, based on what content, to be considered proficient and effective. And then we define what learning should be achieved at different grade levels or over life. No? At a certain point in your life, you must achieve a particular standard. So this is a very important thing because when we translate these standards into grade 3 standards for, let's say, math, or grade 6 standards for, let's say, Araling Panlipunan, we must all still connect. And that ALS and the formal system must also meet those standards. So it's very important that when we think of the basic education structure, we think of the different ways it is delivered, not just through formal school. Okay? And then we have content standards, performance standards, and learning competencies. This is an example of a key stage standard at grade 3 for mother tongue. By the end of grade 3, students will enjoy communicating in their first language on familiar topics for a variety of purposes and audiences using basic vocabulary and phrases. They will read in the first language texts or L1 texts with understanding and create their own stories and texts in their first language. That is the standard for grade 3 mother tongue. For grade 9, for an example in grade 9 is science. So for example, respiratory and circulatory systems working with the other organ systems. So we stipulate what should they know at this point, diba? At the end of this first quarter or first grading period, the children should have knowledge or demonstrate an understanding of how different structures of the circulatory and respiratory systems work together. And then, the performance standard must show how children will be able to conduct an information dissemination activity on effective ways of taking care of the respiratory and circulatory systems. Ibig sabihin, we don't just want children to be able to repeat what you say or what you teach in class. What we want them to be able to do is to convert this knowledge into an application, into a behavior. Yung knowledge conversion na yun, yun ang ginagawa ng guro. Okay? Yung paglipat ng memoryang information into actual behavior, an actual product, let's say a project or an activity, that is the true manifestation of learning. And that's what we need to be able to show. So, hindi lang siya salita. Dapat hanggang sa gawa na achieve natin yung standard. And finally, this is an example of a learning competency. Learners must be able to explain how their respiratory systems work together to transport nutrients, gases, and other molecules to and from the different parts of the body. So when we assess, we will assess that also. So our curriculum is like that. It has content, content standard, performance standard, competency. Now let's look at the whole basic education program. In other words, that framework of the curriculum, it is present in the entire basic education program. So this is the architecture of the program. We have elementary, which is from kindergarten to grade 6. Kasi, di ba, the key stages are K to 3 and then 4 to 6. And then we have junior high school, which is 7 to 10. Now, there's a little emphasis here, if you notice. From grade 7 and 8, technology livelihood education is exploratory. And then in grades 9 and 10, technology livelihood education takes on specializations. Okay. And then we have grades 11 and 12, which constitute our senior high school. Senior high school has three parts. The first part is the core curriculum or the core subjects. The second part is the track. The second part is divided into two. We have contextualized track subjects and then we have specialized track subjects. Now, what are our tracks? The first track is the academic track. So if you imagine your exit, di ba? If you take the academic track, you can go to higher education immediately after high school. The second track is the technical vocational livelihood track, the TVL track. That track allows you to go directly to employment or it allows you to go to middle skills development. The sports track and the arts and design track, they allow you to go anywhere, higher ed or middle skills development or work. And then everyone, if they so choose, can go into entrepreneurship. What is important, I think, is for us to realize that children who choose these tracks, they should be able to go to more than one place. So we don't track them for life. You understand, no? You track them for an option. So they may choose academic track, something happens in their life, they will have to change to tech voc. That's okay. That should be allowable, that should be possible. These are the features of the curriculum. All of these phrases, dami po niyan, no? Learner-centered, inclusive, research-based, standards, competence, seamless, decongested, culture-responsive, culture-sensitive, contextualized, relevant, responsive, flexible, ICT-based, and global. All of those words are in the law. And what we're trying to do in the curriculum areas is make sure that these words come alive in the curriculum. Because otherwise, the law will not be meaningful. So we should be able to make these laws come, these words come alive. We need really a balance between the ideal, the meaningful, and the logically feasible. What is feasible? Diba? We need to be able to find out what is the most responsive track in a particular community. Because baka mamaya mag-offer tayo ng track na walang interesado. So we need to be able to offer the right tracks in the right places. The other one is that we need to have some sort of one-stop shop kind of system. The school or the district together must function as a one-stop shop. If a child cannot go to formal school, in that school or in that district must be access to ALS or ADMs. That must be possible. And of course, finally, we need to build around the needs of the learner. So I'm going to go into more detailed parts of the curriculum. Bear with me. I need to tell you what the bureaus went through to do this because they went through a lot to get to this point. No? First, in looking at 21st century skills, there are four kinds, diba? As I said earlier. What we've had to do is to look at what are the elements in the curriculum that contribute to the 21st century skills. So we harvested these ones. So for example, in learning and innovation skills, all across the curriculum, you will find creativity and curiosity development, critical thinking and problem-solving skills, and risk-taking. So everywhere in the curriculum, there will be these things. In the teacher's guides, there will be collaboration activities. So in other words, we teach them communication and interpersonal skills through collaboration. And then, to proceed, we looked at the curriculum. Let's say this is an example of grade 7. We looked at the curriculum and then we checked. Are there, in specific subjects, learning and innovation skills? So for example, in Filipino, with the content of Ibong Adarna, na isasagawa ng mag-aaral ang malihikhaing pagtatanghal ng ilang saknong ng koridong naglalarawan ng mga pagpapahalagang Pilipino. That particular competency in Filipino grade 7 will contribute to learning and innovation skills because the student is able to show creative representations of what they've read. Then you'll find similar things. For example, in science, the learner investigates the properties of mixtures of varying concentrations using available materials in the community for specific purposes. Again, if the child learns all of these competencies and can perform the performance standards and achieve the performance standards, that child is being helped to develop learning and innovation skills. That's very important. Sometimes, teachers tend to just think about their subject. Diba? At math lang kung math. Diba? Araling panlipunan lang kung araling panlipunan. This time, we have to be more concentric. Diba? We need to be able to look at how the subject matters are actually integrative. And the integration is very hard to do. It's really very hard to do. That's why in a curriculum rendering, in the training on curriculum, we need to show that the curricula lead to the 21st century skills. Hindi pwedeng stand alone. Wala namang nabubuhay na math lang ang alam niya. Di ba? Wala din nabubuhay na English lang ang alam niya. We need to know more things to be able to function well in society. There are features of the curriculum, no? First, the first reform feature, no, and it is a huge reform feature, is the mother tongue-based multilingual education framework. And in this framework, what we are trying to do is to leverage the child's dominant language and use this dominant language as the foundational language of education. You leverage that, you use that, one, why? To make children happy. If they're happy, they will stay in school. Number two, they can communicate with each other better. And then they will learn subject matter better. And three, they will develop concepts in a language that they know. In other words, concept development is not delayed. Concept development happens immediately because they are using a language they know. Fourth, because if they have a strong language, they can learn subsequent languages of the curriculum. At the moment, at present, we have 9 languages already currently in the DepEd, program of MTB-MLE. We expect that there will be more languages, especially from cultural groups. Hopefully, as we use these languages, children also appreciate themselves better and their communities better. But we also need to make sure we achieve the standard of the curriculum. In our curriculum, we are doing a multilingual framework, so we cannot be stuck with our local languages. What we are trying to do is to learn the other languages. So we use the mother tongue so that this set of knowledge in the mother tongue can be transferred to Filipino, transferred to English. So we are actually using the principle of learning transfer. So you have a good foundation, and on this foundation, you learn other things. And I think to be able to reach the goal, which is a multi-literate Filipino learner, we need to make sure that the bridging from mother tongue to Filipino to English is done properly. And that can be achieved through our teacher's guides. Another key concept in the curriculum is contextualization and localization. What is nice about contextualization and localization is that you have to think of where you are so that you can make the curriculum relevant to you. For example, I'll give you examples on that later. But this is in the law. And this is one of the main things that will allow our curriculum to be not singular, but actually more diverse. So we need to make sure that when we localize curriculum, we agree to it. And I think that's a shift in thinking. Diba? The usual thinking is we all have to be the same. But the shift in thinking is important because localization means that different areas in the country will use different materials. They will use different instruments so that they can deliver the standard of the curriculum. The other one that's important in K-12 is the spiraling of content. So we go from basic to complex, and we are spiraling also the competencies. So from spiraled, as I said earlier, kinder to grade 10 is spiraled, we move on to disciplinal in grades 11 and 12. The other feature is TLE, or Technology Vocational Livelihood Education. We are using, for example, we are building on TLE so that we hit the TESDA competencies. No? So we're using the training regulations of TESDA. And this is important for us to understand because this is where we are converging with the rest of the education system. As I said earlier, we are not existing as DepEd alone. What we are trying to do is to make sure that we connect with other agencies that are delivering education. So for example, at the end of grade 10, 11, and 12, children should be able to take national competency examinations administered by TESDA. Now, how did we do that? No? We had to ensure higher education and tech voc readiness. And how are we going to do that? We needed, again, to think of the other education institution or agency in our country, which is CHED. We've looked at the college readiness standards of CHED. In 2012, CHED released this very thick document stipulating what high school graduates must know. And then they released another document saying, these are the new GE courses of college. If you remember, when you went to college, you had 2 years of general education, about 61 units. Now there are only 36. Those 36 units are listed, no? And what we've done is we look backwards. Remember, when we think of learning, you always think with the end in mind. What is the end you want to achieve? Therefore, you work backwards and you try to see how do you achieve that. So we looked at how we connected the new GE curriculum of CHED to the senior high school subjects and then to grades 7 to 10. So for example, math, we have, of course, math in grade 7 to 10, and then we have general math in senior high school And we also have statistics and probability in senior high school. And then when they get to college, they will have mathematics in the world. So we are connected that way. And I think this cohesion or this coherence is very important. They always tell us our students are not ready for college. This is a way by which we are trying to make sure they are. So how did we do that? We worked with CHED. We brought them into the curriculum development process. So we made sure that we align core and contextualized subjects to college readiness standards and the GE curriculum. But more importantly, we invited them to come and join us. It's an interesting mix, no? Basic education specialists and higher education specialists coming together. It's an interesting thing because they know their disciplines, di ba? We know it for basic ed, but we know the competency and performance constructions. They know content. And so what we had to do was to navigate this relationship. We also did that with TESDA. Because TESDA naman is puro competency. Diba? And what we needed to do was to be able to connect that to our content. And we did the same thing. No? We integrated technical vocational education, skills, competencies, and qualifications in junior and senior high school so that they can take the national competencies. And then what we did was we brought them in again in our workshops. We also made sure that our common competencies are present. Kasi these are non-negotiables. In the same way that the GE curriculum of CHED is a non-negotiable, the common competencies of TESDA are also non-negotiable. So what we need to do is to navigate that. How do we bridge that? So that process is the curriculum development process. The other day I was in a school and I was explaining this process. And the teachers in the school told me, "We didn't know it went through a very long process. We thought you get a curriculum, you put there what you want, and then you give it to us for implementation." And I was telling them, no, that's not how it works. No, the curriculum process is actually very tedious and slow, and you review, and you go back to it, and you review. So let me show you the process. So we had curriculum guide writing workshops, and you have to remember this has been going on for 3 years. In that workshop, there is a construction of a committee. There are people who do the work. So there's somebody from the central office, there's somebody from the field, there's an internal and external reviewers, internal and external reviewers, and then there are people from either TESDA or CHED who will help us craft. And then we had somebody to do the encoding for us. These people were involved and they came from very many institutions. I'm sure there are more institutions, but just let me show you how many people we had to coordinate with. And then we went through this process. So there is a crafting process. The crafting process is the first step and it releases a draft number one. The draft number one is sent to a reviewer. And you know, the reviewer and the crafter, the drafter, they're not the same people. And because they are not the same people, sometimes they don't have the same perspective, they don't put emphasis or importance on the same concepts. And so, the comment of the reviewer is returned to the crafters. And these comments now are mediated. We have to go comment by comment by comment and see, do we agree? Is it all right? Or is it not okay? In most cases, we are able to navigate this process. In some cases, it's a little bit more difficult. Siyempre, sometimes we are married to our work. And it is hard to accept criticism. Diba? Pero with proper mediation and proper intervention, it's possible to be able to come up with an agreement. And I think that's the important thing. Because unless there is agreement, we cannot come up with a final curriculum guide. So for a final curriculum guide to come out is actually a meeting of minds. People need to agree that this is what a high school student must know, must be able to do. This is what the exit should lead to. And so that's a very important point. Sometimes we forget that and we are stuck to our discipline. And we remind those who are tending to be that way that, you know, this is now what children should know. We should remember the child, the learner. It's not about the discipline, it's about the learner. After that, when that is successful, and usually naman it is, actually we're successful in all, we go to language review. The language review process is tricky because you need to find the correct reviewer for the subject. So for instance, it's hard to find a language reviewer for TLE because usually a language editor will want to change the verb of a sentence, no, to make it more appropriate. But in TLE, the verb is the most important thing of all because the verb tells you what action is going to be measured. So a language reviewer cannot change the verb. So these things are very important. No? And again, we send back the review to the crafters, they mediate, they agree, diba? And then finally, it goes through copy and proofreading. So as much as possible, by the time it gets to language review, there should not be any more conceptual error. No more conceptual error. By the time it gets to copy and proofreading, there should be no more grammar error, no more language error. And so, the only possible errors we might have are typographical. And if they're not typographical, we have a problem. So we have to fix that problem and go back to the content review, go back to the language review before we go back again to copy review. Kuha nyo? Madugo siya, diba? Mm-mm. So ibig sabihin, the better the first draft, the better for everybody. And so that's what we were trying to stress the whole time. When it is copy edited, then we load it up on the website and I'll show you where it is. But before that, we created a coding system. We coded the learning competencies of the curriculum guide per learning area. We coded because one, we needed to find out, do we have all the competencies that we need to have? Number two, did we load them up with too many competencies? Number three, in a spiral curriculum, the competency should be balanced. Kasi the word balance is important in curriculum development. So, for example, one of the most simple but very informative comments I heard was, when I was doing the coding, sabi nung isang specialist, I learned that there were 70 plus competencies in biology, but only 35 something or something in chemistry. And so he could see that it was a little lopsided. And that is a very important insight because of the coding process. This is the coding legend. The objective of it all was to do things by consensus as much as possible. No? So what we did was there's a learning area, and then the grade level, and then what is the content, and for what quarter, and then for what week, and what is the competency number. So, for example, this competency is H9S-4G-H-34. It means it is for health, grade 9, for the prevention of substance abuse and use, fourth quarter, week 7 to 8, and the competency is suggest healthy alternatives to cigarettes and alcohol to promote healthy lifestyle. So when you code that competency, let me just explain. Let's look at the curriculum. No? That it allowed us now to look at what we had in the field. So we looked at the learning resources that were available in the field. So we could identify what learning resources were available and then we coded them also. We're not yet done, but this is what the curriculum guide looks like. So when you go online, this is what it will look like. It will have the content, the content standards, the performance standards, the learning competencies, the code of the competency, and the learning materials that contain this learning competency. In other words, if I look at the learning guide in science and health mixtures, print by BEE, I will be able to get a learning material for teaching, describing different objects based on their different characteristics. If I go to BEAM, Grade 3, Unit 4, Learning Materials, Science 3, Materials Module 1, I will be able to find a material that will help me teach that competency. We call this harvesting. We harvested from other education interventions that had happened in the last 30, 40 years. And we looked at them and we tried to match. That process is not yet done. It's a long process. The other thing that's important about coding the competency is now we can use that code to code the National Achievement Test. So we know that the National Achievement Test actually is connected to the curriculum, and that is very important for assessment. This is a curriculum guide for grade 9 math. And then we also have a curriculum map. The curriculum map shows us the content that is being spiraled across all the grade levels. So we studied first quarter, second quarter, third quarter, fourth quarter, grade 1, 2, and 3, and we looked at how the content was being spread out. And we know that it's not too much content in every quarter. The problem was kasi the curriculum was congested, too much content per quarter. When we did this, we were able to say, maybe you need to lessen here because it's a lot of content. Maybe you need to add there because there's too little content. So that kind of mapping is very important. So in other words, what am I saying? We looked at the curriculum forwards, backwards, and sideways. We looked at it in as many ways as possible so we could ensure that we were actually spreading out the content and that we were covering the necessary content. If you want to look at the curriculum guides, they're there. You can download them. When we find an error, we take it down. We correct the error, then we put it back up.